Greetings to all fans of the StarCraft universe. As you understood from the title, we will talk about the Zerg virus, or as it is also called, the hyper-evolutionary virus, which is a terrible weapon of the Swarm, very effective and plays a crucial role in the assimilation of other species. According to known sources, only one race called the Protoss managed to physically and mentally resist the infection. But first thing first, let's go. The Zerg hyper-evolutionary virus is an infectious disease that infects living organisms. In the game itself, the most obvious example is the infested terrans.
I am Zerg, live for the Swarm, prepare to die.
But perhaps not everyone knows that in addition to people, the Zerg managed to infect man's closest friends, dogs. Yes, in addition to prisoners, these four-legged creatures also went on a journey across the galaxy. They became known as Roverlisks. This name was given to them by General Duke. These creatures were created by the Zerg Queen from the Kukulkan brood during the Battle of Bekaro, based on genetic material obtained from a mastiff named Old Blue, who was quite a large dog. Outwardly, they looked terrifying. Bony, spiky spines protruded from under their backs. Armored clothes grew from their shoulders. Four-stalked eyes provided them with excellent visibility and a wide angle of vision. Roverlisks have tusk-like fangs and talons the size of scimitars. They can also explode on contact with the victim, much like infested terrans do. Little else is known about these creatures, as they were all observed on Bekaro by the energy creature that awoke from the Zelnaga temple. Let's talk a little about the virus itself, or rather, its nature. And for this, we will have to draw a parallel with the viruses known on Earth in order to have something to base on. Well, and in turn for this, we should turn to such a wonderful science as biology. Yes, I know, guys, I'm already boring you with it, but be patient a little, since for the completeness of the picture and the understanding of the virus physiology, this is necessary. So, what is a virus? A virus is a non-cellular infectious agent that can reproduce only inside living cells. Roughly speaking, while a virus is outside a cell, it doesn't show any signs of life and behaves like biopolymer particles, proteins, nucleic acids, polysaccharides, etc. Viruses affect all types of organisms, from plants and animals to bacteria and archaea. They are the most numerous biological form, at least on planet Earth. Viral particles, virions, consist of two or three components: genetic material in the form of DNA or RNA, a protein shell, capsid, protecting these molecules, and in some cases, additional lipid shells. Depending on what type of nucleic acid the genetic material is represented by, DNA-containing viruses and RNA-containing viruses are distinguished. Considering that the Zerg are based on genetic material encoded in a DNA molecule, most likely the virus they produce will be based on deoxyribonucleic acid. But this is not certain. Although in support of the above, it can be noted that one of the reasons for the impossibility of assimilation and infestation of the Protoss is the opposite of the latter's DNA to the Zerg DNA, and it can be assumed that already at the stage preceding the replication of the virus, the DNA of both species cannot form a stable nucleotide structure, which is why the integration process becomes impossible. On the other hand, the Zerg virus may show signs of retrovirus that uses a reverse transcription mechanism to replicate its genome when viral DNA is synthesized on the viral RNA matrix in the cell. Such viruses are initially based on an RNA molecule. Little is known about the origins of viruses as part of the biosphere. It is believed that some may have evolved from plasmids, small DNA molecules that can be passed from one cell to another, while others may have originated from bacteria. In evolution, and most importantly for us, or more precisely for the Zerg, viruses are an important means of horizontal gene transfer, which determines genetic diversity. Viruses vary in shape, from simple helical and icosahedral to more complex structures. The average virus is about 1/100th the size of the average bacterium, around 100 nanometers. So how does the infection process itself occur? Considering that the Zerg virus doesn't simply use the resources of a healthy cell for its own reproduction, but directly introduces itself into the host genetic structure, we can say that we are talking about a so-called provirus. For example, most retroviruses on our planet have provirus properties, including the human immunodeficiency virus, HIV. In the most general form, infection at the level of a single cell consists of several successive stages. Attachment of the virus to the cell surface, penetration through the cell's outer membranes, exposure of the genome, integration of its own DNA into the DNA of a healthy cell, synthesis transcription of the virus nucleic acid with the formation of daughter molecules of genomic NA, and in the case of DNA-containing viruses, informational viral mRNA, synthesis of virus-specific proteins, assembly of new variants, and their release from the affected cell. The passage of all these stages constitutes one reproduction cycle. At the level of a system of cells in the form of a tissue or organ, reproduction cycles are often asynchronous, and the virus penetrates healthy cells from infected cells. In an experiment, synchronization of replication cycles can be achieved due to high multiplicity of infection, in which each cell contains at least 10 infectious virus particles. Virus multiplication is usually accompanied by suppression of the biological functions of the cell and disturbances in cellular metabolism. In extreme cases, it leads to complete destruction of the cell, with the release of viral progeny. The alteration of the original genetic material in the cells and the rapid rate of virus reproduction in the case of the Zerg cause quick mutations of the infested species. In addition, the virus also acts on a mental level, suppressing the thought processes of the organism and subordinating it to the collective will of the swarm. Also, the fact that the Zerg collective mind is involved in the infection process was mentioned in an interview by Brian Kindragon. Considering that the Protoss have high psionic potential, enhanced by the color or the energy of the void, depending on the practice infections, this gives them additional protection from infestation by the Zerg virus. But in history, there is at least one case when the Protoss was still infested with the hyper-evolutionary virus. This was facilitated by a special kind of creep. In 2502, a sample of the Zerg creep was delivered to the Protoss Advanced Experimental Facility, PAX. In order to put an end to the swarm once and for all, as well as to deprive the Zerg of the opportunity to develop infrastructure and feed from the creep, Protoss scientists began to create a mutating viral reagent capable of causing massive tissue damage to the creep. But as usually happens, the experiment got out of control, and the Protoss themselves fell under the influence of the creep. It spread throughout the complex. It seemed that this biological substance was not only alive, but even intelligent. And what's more, it had impressive psionic abilities, clouding the Protoss minds on the station and depriving them of the ability to normally interact with the color. In the end, only one scientist, Guru, survived, who nevertheless sacrificed himself, destroying the coolant crystal and burying the entire complex under a layer of ice. But sometime after the incident, the station was found by the Terrans, and the creep sample they found was quite viable. So, who knows, perhaps we will hear about it again. But let's return to analysis of the classic virus. Terrans, unlike the Protoss, are not so lucky and are easily infected. Their psionic potential was noticed by the Overmind, and the virus was used to assimilate it. Queen of Blades was an example of successful infestation, but most Terrans, even psionics, were turned into mindless zombies. However, Kerrigan later made efforts to correct the situation, and even succeeded in infecting Ethan Stewart. Speaking of the loss of free will, it should be noted that the virus primarily affects the centers responsible for thinking, coordination, and motor activity. In the case of the Terrans, this is the frontal lobe of the cerebral cortex and the cerebellum. The virus is usually spread by virophages, which emit parasitic biotoxins, infecting all organisms around. These Virophages are installed by special Zerg combat units, infestors, and are usually located near barracks, stations, colonies, and other populated areas. Since Virophages are capable of independently producing creep, their placement is quite possible on space platforms. The virus can also spread through water, and remembering the events of the First Great War, queens also took part in the infestation process. They were the ones who infected the Terran command centers, and then the infection spread to all stationed personnel. Extreme mutations of the Zerg virus turn Terrans into creatures known as aberrations, but I will tell you about them, the infested marines and other infested ones, in a separate video. During the war with Aemon, the latter's forces were armed with a particularly virulent strain of the virus. His infested minions moved with terrifying speed and spread the disease rapidly. Hallucinogens in their blood could cause hysteria in even the most steadfast warriors. The Zerg virus mutates quickly enough to make it impossible to cure. However, the Protoss developed a nanotechnological serum that was able to reverse the infestation process. It was a sample of the serum that was injected into Alexis Tukov, which allowed him to return to his normal human form. Although, as it turned out, this was a temporary effect. Also, scientists of the Confederate Resistance Forces were able to develop a way to partially preserve the subject's sanity, but apparently these developments became irrelevant at the time of the Second Great War events. By the time the Swarm had developed a particularly dangerous strain of the virus, the infested Terrans retained some signs of intelligence, allowing them to operate weapons and in some cases even equipment. However, the virus made the infested ones vulnerable to UV radiation.
It looks like they burrow underground by day and emerge only at night. The virus must make them vulnerable to the high UV output of Meinhof's star.
Dr. Ariel Hansen was also working on a cure for the Zerg virus. However, she was unable to obtain an effective sample of the serum. In an alternative version of the events on the planet Haven, if Raynor chooses the Protoss site and destroys the colony, Dr. Hansen desperately tries to use an unfinished sample of the serum on herself, having first infected herself with the virus.
This isn't right! I thought you were a better man than this, Jim! I won't accept that! Every one of my people can be saved. I'm close to finding the cure, I know it!
Oh God, not you too.
As it turned out, the serum didn't work in the end, and Ariel turned into a monster.
Do it. Finish it.
Although the mutation was stopped at 99.3%, that is, the medicine only worked at 0.7%. The most effective cure for the virus is the Zelnaga artifact, the Keystone, if it is properly configured, of course. It allows you to separate human genes from Zerg genes, which we could see in Winds of Liberty, when Sarah Kerrigan was turned back into a human. So why is the virus so important to the Swarm? While the Primal Zerg, being individual creatures, receive new essence by eating their victims and thus improve their species through mutation, the Zerg of the Swarm, being a collective organism, use a hyper-evolutionary virus for assimilation. Each new species of creatures that possess properties useful to the Zerg is infested with this virus, and then after mutation is included in the Swarm. The victim's DNA, modified by the Zerg mutagen, is added to the general database of the Swarm DNA. And the larva, which contains all the necessary genetic information about each Swarm creature, can develop into any individual, depending on the situation and needs. Well, finally, let's talk about where the Zerg virus originally came from. I think Abathur had something to do with it. The Zerg were able to parasitically infiltrate other organisms and even control their motor activity. and by manipulating hidden evolutionary processes, they could direct mutation in a necessary manner. But as the swarm grew, a more effective means of assimilating new species was needed, something that could quickly clear out a huge population of a hostile species and add it to the swarm, even without the need to involve the Zerg themselves in the infestation process. To do this, all that was needed was to isolate the swarm's DNA with the most essential basic gene sets, add parasitic properties to it, and wrap it in a protein shell, capsid. As a result, we have one of the most terrible bioweapons in the surf of one of the most terrible races in the universe. Not bad, right? In general, there is no limit to perfection, and the Zerg know this like no one else. This is where my story ends. Thank you for your attention, and if you were really interested, do me a little favor, share this video on your social network. In this way you will help popularize the video and therefore contribute to the development of the channel. And the faster the channel will develop, the more interesting videos will be released. In general, in one word, evolution. Thanks again to everyone, goodbye. See you soon on the channel.